Hello, everyone. My name is Julie Hawkins, and I am part of the One Church at Chapel Hill in Gig Harbor, Washington, and I'm so glad to be with you today. Now, I have some good news for you, and I have some bad news for you. We already heard a little bad news from Scott earlier, but I'm going to assume that you like to receive your news like my 10-year-old daughter, Marguerite. Marguerite likes to receive her good news and her bad news in a good news sandwich. Start with the good news, then you get a little bit of bad news, and then add a slice of good news at the end to make it a little bit easier. So let's start with the good news. The good news is that we always have hope, and our hope, it is eternal, and it is unshakable. The good news is that we have the good news because we have Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And so no matter how tough your situation may feel, God is bigger. And we know that the end of the story is that Christ has his victory and Christ gets all his glory. And that is good news every single day. Now let's get to the bad news. The bad news is that the American church is in a numerical decline. Let me rattle off a couple of stats for you. The number of people that take a survey and check a box saying that their religious preference is Christian has dropped from 78% to 63% in 14 years. In 1960, 63% of Americans attended church weekly on Sundays. A 2019 study found that while 40% of Americans say that they regularly attend church, people who study those figures say that a more realistic figure is that 18% of Americans regularly attend church. And it's important to note that regularly attending church now means going to church once every 5 weeks. Yeah. When we hear those numbers, it should not come as a surprise to us that every week, it is estimated that between 75 to 150 churches in the United States close their doors permanently. That's bad news. And on top of that, there's also all of the external pressure that we're feeling. We just heard from a panel about the persecuted church, and we recognize that mounting tension that we see right here in the United States. There's a sense that there is a shift in the wind. And the reality is, as much as we want to fight it, that shift probably won't change in this post-Christendom world that we live in. If you hear those numbers and you feel a little bit down about it, don't worry, you're not alone. Because a recent study found that 42% of pastors thought about quitting full-time ministry in the last year. That means that half of the teaching elders in this room probably considered hanging up their robe for the last time in the last year. And the other half who didn't consider that, they weren't much better off. The study found that both of those groups of pastors cited three ministry challenges: immense stress, political division, and feeling lonely and isolated as their greatest ministry challenges. I wonder, can any of you relate to that? I know that I can. And so I think that before we go on, we need to pause for a moment, and we need to recognize that many people came to this General Assembly feeling depleted and feeling at the end of their line. So please have grace on your brothers and sisters and encourage them. Pray with one another. Let's live into that word. If you look down at your name tag, there's a word on it. It says recharge. Let's live into that this week and let's recharge each other. And remember that there is still another slice of good news. The good news is that this isn't the first time that the church has been in a tight spot. Our text today, it finds us in Acts 4, 23 through 31. I encourage you to pull out your Bibles and open up or go to your app. I want you to actually like look in the words while we're reading this, but it finds the church in a similar position with an uncertain future, this amount of external pressure, And the leaders of the church were shouldering the weight of it all. And their response should be the exact same as our response. We should live into the response of the early church, because their response was one that was powered by prayer and bold proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So hear the word of the Lord today. In Acts 4:23, when they were released, they went to their friends and reported what the chief priests and elders had said to them. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices together to God and said, "Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them, who through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said by the Holy Spirit, 'Why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his anointed. For truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness while you stretch out your hand to heal and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus.' And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and continued to speak the word of God with boldness." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our text finds Peter and John recently released from jail. This was their first time in jail. It certainly would not be their last. And the short version of what got them into this position is they had been at the temple the day before and they had healed a man. And everybody was astonished by it. They wanted to know how it happened. So Peter told them that it happened through faith in Jesus. And everybody thought it was so incredible that 5,000 men came to believe that day. Isn't that incredible? It was so astonishing that the chief priests and the Sadducees, they noticed and they threw Peter and John in jail. If you flip back to the beginning of chapter 4, you can see what the official charge was against them. In 4:2, it says that the chief priests and the Sadducees were greatly annoyed. Yeah, that's right. Peter and John went to prison because they were so annoying. I wonder how many of you have younger siblings. You know that the charge of being so annoying does not hold up in court. And it did not hold up in temple court either. They found no reason that they could hold them or keep them, and they had to release Peter and John. But when they did, they were forbidden to speak or teach in the name of Jesus again. And Peter and John, they knew this wasn't just a hand slap. These weren't empty threats. They knew the power of the chief priests and the Sadducees. They knew what they were capable of. They had seen just a few months before what they had done to Jesus. And so when they left, on their release, they left with an uncertain future of this infant church and a tremendous amount of stress and pressure. And that's where we find them. That's where we pick up our text today. Now, there are a number of things that you might expect to happen when Peter and John were released from prison. Peter and John, they might have scurried away to some upper room to spend a little bit of time hiding away until things calmed down. But no, we see that the very first thing that they did is they went to their friends, because the Christian life is best lived in community. In fact, the Christian life is always lived in community. And when they went to their friends, they could have aggrandized their part in the story, or they could have sugarcoated what the chief priest said to them. They could have come and said, "Oh my gosh, it was so incredible. We were at the temple and we healed this man, and everybody was like, 'Wow, that's so crazy.' And we told them it was in the name of Jesus. 5,000 people were saved. We were arrested, but we got released." They could have done that. But instead, they reported exactly what the chief priest said. They wanted their friends to know exactly what they were up against. And you could expect that their friends, the disciples, in response, that a couple of them might have said, you know, I'm not in for this. I'm going to leave now. I don't want to take up this fight. You know that one of the disciples, probably Andrew, it's always Andrew, in my opinion, that he would have pulled out the first century equivalent of a whiteboard, and he said, let's make a plan, a strategy for how we're going to face this together. You can be certain that there were some strong opinions or arguing. And you would expect all of this because we have four Gospels that are full of the disciples reacting just like that. Gospels about the disciples arguing about who was the greatest, talking about all that they had done, making plans and strategies for how they could do things better, doubting, hiding, running away. But now the disciples are eyewitnesses. Now the disciples, they had seen Jesus on the cross. They had seen him dead and buried in a tomb. These disciples, they'd seen the stone rolled away. They saw the empty tomb. They had seen the resurrected Jesus, their king. They had seen Jesus ascend into heaven. They had seen and received the gift of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. And so this time, the trial, it hit a bit different, didn't it? And their immediate response, it was one that where they lifted their voices together, united in prayer. Their immediate response was one of prayer. There are a couple things in life that I feel like I can just talk about forever. One of them is that my husband Joey makes the best guacamole in the entire world. Yeah, we got some people that can testify to that. Another thing is that the song Good Vibrations by the Beach Boys, greatest song ever written in the English language. Like, come at me, I will talk to you about it forever. I found out yesterday that just like we expect the second coming of Jesus, I expect the second coming of the Seattle Supersonics in Seattle. They're gonna come home, and I can talk about it for a long time. But the fourth and most important thing that I can talk about at length is that our first response should always be prayer. Prayer should be our holy reflex. Like when you go to the doctor and they hit your elbows and your knees and they see how quickly you respond to things, our holy reflex should be one of prayer. When you're overwhelmed by the world, when you can't handle what's in the news. Anybody had a story in the news recently where you thought, I just don't even know how to respond to this? Our holy reflex should be prayer. When you get that email of criticism from a congregant, or you feel like you can't handle one more unanswered email from somebody who it appears isn't going to come back. When you find yourself struggling with the whens and the whys and the what ifs and the hows, our holy reflex should be prayer. I want us to be a denomination that is on our knees in prayer so much that every year at General Assembly, we have to take a special offering to pay for all of your knee replacements because we're on our knees that much. And here's what I love about the prayer of the early church. It doesn't begin with a problem. They don't start by asking for something. Instead, it begins with praise. Listen to what they prayed for. They lifted their voices together and said, Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them. And then they prayed. They praised God that he knew all of this. In fact, he had foretold it through David. He knew that this was going to happen. In fact, it says that it was by his hand and his plan that this all happened. It's a very reformed prayer, isn't it? There's a little bit of the Westminster chapter 5 in there, that God, the creator of all things, doth uphold, direct, dispose, and govern all creatures, actions, and things. Because they recognize that God is sovereign, and they began with praise of him, that even in this difficult moment, he was in control. He was the one who allowed this to happen, and they praise him as that creator and sustainer of all things. Is that our first thought? Is our first impulse even to pray? Is our first thought when we see the problems and pressures of this world to start by praising God? I think we should try it. I think we should see how that fits. Because the thing is that when we begin to praise God, we remind ourselves of his glory and his wisdom. We remember his power, his justice, his goodness, his mercy. And we hear those echoes of the words that Peter would later write in his first epistle, that after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. When we begin with praise instead of the problem, you know what happens? Our perspective on that problem shifts in light of the eternal glory of our great God. And we're reminded that whatever we are struggling with, it's only for a little while. This suffering is only for a little while. We shift away from asking that question of why. Why is this happening? Why is this going on? To the answer of who. Who is our great God? And we turn to praise. When our petitions come from the wings of praise of our great God, it changes how we pray, and it changes what we pray for. Let's look at what they prayed for in our text. They said, Lord, look upon the threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. The disciples, they didn't pray that God would release them from the situation that they were in. They didn't pray that things would stop or change. It's almost like they knew that persecution was coming. It's almost like these eyewitnesses, they believed that Jesus meant it when he said, you must take up your cross and follow me, and that they would lose their life for his name's sake. It's almost like they still had the words of the Great Commission ringing in their ears, that they still could hear Jesus saying, go into all the world and make disciples. It's almost like they could still hear like the tone and the volume of his voice when he commanded them to go into Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And so they didn't pray for their safety. They didn't pray that the danger would stop. Instead, they prayed that they would bring the gospel forth. John Calvin writes of this prayer. He says, they are not so much careful for their own safety as for the increase and advancement of the kingdom of Christ. In this moment of uncertainty, all seemed lost. They were in very great danger. And they prayed that they would be recharged so they might recharge with the boldness to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. And God would do wondrous works through them so that the world might have faith in Jesus. We see, of course, that God answered their prayer. He answered their prayer in a room, shaking, Holy Spirit-filled way. And then they were able to continue with confidence to preach and proclaim the gospel. I wonder what that looks like in our own lives. Like, what is the thing that is keeping us from preaching and proclaiming the gospel? This last week, I felt just about at my limit. If you know me, you know that I like to have a lot of things on my plate and I like to run at a pretty fast speed. But this last couple of weeks, they were downright chaotic. They were too much for me. It was my kids' last couple weeks of school. In fact, their dad is picking them up right about now from their last day of school. I was finishing a class for some doctoral work that I'm doing. I had this big sermon that I was preaching weighing over me in the back of my head. My kids got norovirus in the middle of this. Any parent, yeah, all of you parents, oh, you've seen what norovirus does to a household. And in the middle of all that, we were like, you know what would be a great idea? Let's buy a house. And let's sell our house. So I was feeling a little bit under pressure. And one morning, I was sitting in my closet, surrounded by boxes, getting ready for the house stager to come. And I thought to myself, Lord, relieve this pressure. And I realized that that was my moment to pray for boldness, to proclaim the gospel. And so I knelt down in my closet and I prayed that I said, Lord, you know what I'm going through. You know what I'm up against. Give me the boldness to proclaim your gospel. And I prayed for a specific friend that I hadn't seen for a few months and that I hadn't texted or called or anything. I have to tell you, the closet didn't shake. Not so much as like a blouse shimmering in the wind. Nothing super profound. But 20 minutes later, I had just dropped my daughter off at an appointment. I was sitting in my car. I was working on this sermon, laptop in my lap. And I turned and I looked, and guess who was sitting in the car next to me? My friend. And I rolled down my window, and she said, what are you working on? Can you guess what happened next? I got to proclaim the gospel across the parking lot, window to window with my friend. It's going to be a long journey for her, but the conversation ended with her saying, man, I would really like to talk about this stuff more. Can we commit to having conversations about Jesus over the summer? Praise the Lord. This is a huge deal. And so, brothers and sisters, no matter what you're facing right now, maybe you are feeling that pain of a church in decline. Maybe you're even considering being one of those churches that closes its doors. Or maybe you're feeling some sort of external pressure. Maybe you're even feeling persecution. Maybe you're exhausted. Maybe you're angry. Maybe you're really wanting to fight back. Or maybe you're apathetic. You're done. You're over it. I want you to think about whatever that problem is for you, that distraction. I want you to think about your bad news in your life. Whatever that bad news is that you're dealing with, we have good news that we have to share with the world. My mom used to always tell me when I was complaining about having a bad day, she'd say, Julie, there's always somebody who's having a worse day than you. It went over really well when I was a teenager. But she was right. There was always somebody who was having a worse day than me. And the truth is that the world out there, the world that doesn't know Jesus, that doesn't have that good news, no matter how bad your day is going, their day is worse. Like eternally worse. The world needs to hear. Just like Peter said the day before at the temple that Christ suffered for sinners and that our sins are blotted out and their sins may be blotted out too through the blood of Jesus. And that through the blood of Jesus, times of refreshing may come out of the presence of the Lord. Our good news is a kingdom come solution to all of the bad news that is out there. And so I don't want you to let whatever you have going on in your life stop you from sharing that good news. I want you to be a proclaimer of the good news of Jesus. And that starts with us praying that God would grant us the ability to continue, the confidence to continue to speak his word with all boldness. I love that our denomination is renewing our call to evangelism. I think that it is so important that we make it a hallmark of who we are to take the good news of Jesus out into the world. And I believe that that begins first and foremost with prayer, uniting our hearts together. There are a lot of things that we can be divided on, but we can unite our hearts in prayer that we might be recharged through the power of prayer so that we can recharge the battlefield and proclaim the gospel to the world that needs it. And so I want us to start tonight, today, by practicing that. I want us to spend time together in prayer that we might be the denomination that boldly proclaims the name of Jesus. And so I'm going to ask you to stand, and I'm going to ask you that in that spirit of unity, that you would lift your hands, which is a posture that the early church often took when they prayed. Maybe they took it when they were praying this prayer right here. But I want us to pray together, unite our hearts as we pray that the Lord might make us a people that boldly proclaim his gospel. Let's pray together. Father, we begin with praise of your almighty name. We praise you as the creator of all things, the sustainer of all life. Everything in this world was made by the power of your hand. Thank you, God. Father, we know that nothing is done apart from your will, that you are sovereign over all. And so we praise you that even though we feel like we're in a season of bad news, that you knew that this would happen. You knew that this was coming. In fact, you even ordained it to be so. And so we praise you for that. Now, Father, you know what we are facing. And so we pray, Lord, we pray that we would be a denomination that boldly proclaims your gospel to the world. Would you give us the confidence to speak your name? Give us the confidence to preach your name. We pray, Lord, that you would give us whatever tools we need, whatever tools we need in the name of Jesus to show the world your power and your glory. Father, we pray for those earth-shaking, rattling, Holy Spirit-filled moments that show that we know you and we are loved by you. Bring us those conversations each day. And we pray all these things in the matchless name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.